I'm Scott McCauley along with Zach Graves, and welcome to the Knight Show on MUKnightsTV, an inside look at the Marian University football program and Marian athletics. And the football team is on to the quarterfinals. They will play Cumberlands, the Patriots, in round two of the NAIA Championship Football Series. Zach, for the third time this year, Marian played in really crummy weather. It was cold, heavy rain throughout, a difficult opening round matchup against Reinhardt. That was a gutsy, hard-fought, that was as good of a defensive football game that we've seen in a long, long time. And Marian came out on top. What were your thoughts on Saturday?
Well, as soon as the draw came out and you started looking at the opponent and how highly ranked they were on defense and running the football, and you're like, wow, is this really going to be the first round matchup for the team that finished number two in the country? So you expected a great grinded out type of game, limited possessions, you know, all that stuff. And then you come out, opening kickoff return, a couple interceptions, and you're like, wow, is this a flashback over here?
I mean, you got to understand, in the first 5 minutes, there's a 92-yard kickoff return, an interception, a near pick six. Marion's almost down 14-0 5 minutes in.
It's so easy to just phone it in at that point. But what I noticed was the team wasn't going to, you know, let that be their story of 2019. They all got together. They hyped each other up offensively and defensively, and they just grinded that game out, and it was a really impressive performance.
And for the head football coach, Mark Henninger, he picks up the win. Marian is now in the quarterfinals for the first time since 2016, and pretty incredible that that game, you can turn it over to the defense, and they dominated a really good Reinhardt offensive team. Dominated them.
They really did. I mean, you talk about less than 100 yards of total offense in the game. Going in, they were averaging, Reinhardt, 281 yards rushing.
On the ground, rushing.
On the ground, just rushing. And you allowed them less than 100 yards of total offense. One play over 10 yards. Lights out. It's been week in, week out. And it's scary to think that this team improves every week.
Yeah.
They're so dominant, and they improve. They're playing really good football.
And I think what Marian showed us a lot is the leadership that's on this team. And Mark Henninger has talked about all throughout the season on the show about how leadership is changing. And we hear the players talk about family. A lot of us were anxious when it's 7-0 and it's first down and goal to go after the interception. And Johnny William makes the play of the game on tackle on interception. He will join us today on the Knight Show, as will Ryley Pease. It's first down and goal to go. You're down by two scores this quick. There are a lot of Marian people who are thinking, oh, no, but this team rises up and does some things that we haven't seen many Marian defenses do. And there's been some great ones. Don't get me wrong. There have been some incredible defenses.
Yeah.
This one knew all we needed was just give us 2 yards and we'll make the play, and they do.
I think, you know, the leadership is the biggest thing that you point out to all of that. We have had some really good defenses, and I think back to like 2011, that team was incredible. You lose on the last play of the game for the semifinals, we come up short. And then in 2012, they used that as fuel. Last year, they were undefeated. In the 2018 campaign, they're undefeated, and they have a heartbreaker here at home in the first round. These guys were all so young, they used that as fuel, came together as a team. Leaders really separated themselves and have it's made the difference this year, and I think you saw it on Saturday. You're down like that, have an easy chance to just throw it in, and they rallied and came back.
Here's what the Marian defense has done now this season, regular season and one postseason game. The touchdown scored by Reinhardt was on a kickoff return, so that does not – for the sake of this, that does not count against the Marian defense. When you take those pick six that have happened throughout the year here at home, the Marian defense has allowed 3 touchdowns in 24 quarters at home this year. 3 touchdowns. And for those of you that watch on the telecast on home and road, you know that we mention this all the time. Marian has faced the defense. First and second string defense has faced 124 drives this year. They've given up points on 10 of those. 8% of the time the opposing offense takes the field, they score points. 6 touchdowns, 4 field goals. This is as dominant of a unit that you can see right now in the country.
It really is. And, you know, last year we thought they were really young, but they were putting up similar statistics,
Yes, they were.
And we were like, this is going to be, you know, a dominant team. And I just think, again, the leadership, all these guys being a year older, This year just feels different. They're all locked in, and they're just playing lights out.
Well, they're back in the second round for the first time since 2016. Marian is 4-2 all-time in the quarterfinals. Second straight week, they will face a Mid-South foe. This week, it's Cumberlands. They check in at 10-1. They defeated Kaiser 28-24. First road win for the Patriots in postseason history, and this will be their third straight game against an undefeated team. And to put it in perspective, in preseason, this squad was picked to finish 17th. They were 17th in the country in the preseason polls. We'll talk more about Cumberland's later on in the program. We're going to hear from the head football coach, Mark Henninger. We'll hear from defensive back Ryley Pease. And we'll hear from the terrific wide receiver, Johnny William, as well. And we'll catch you up to date what's going to be happening elsewhere in the quarters in the playoffs. He's Zach. I'm Scott. This is the Knight Show on MU Knights TV.
At Marian University, we will challenge you because you want to change our world. But understand, you're not in this alone. There will be mentors preparing you to lead, people of faith, and professors with real-world experience, ensuring that you're prepared for your career. When you leave Marian, you'll be ready when life asks the question, what are you made of?
Back on the Knight Show on MU Knights TV, we're joined by Knights defensive back Ryley Pease. We've been trying to get you on the show all season long, but you have some evening classes.
Yes, sir.
We can mix it up. Glad to have you on the show today. Congratulations on the playoff win. All right, let's talk about your interception right off the bat. Was it as easy as it looked? Because that ball's in the air. Everyone in the stands sees you come over. Is that the easiest ball to catch or one of the hardest passes to try and catch on your interception?
It was kind of tricky. I mean, he honestly threw it right to me, but with the weather being the way it was a little difficult, but concentrated on it and try to replace my hands under it and reel it in. So.
It's your second year starting at safety here at Marian University, but in high school, you played both ways and you were a quarterback at Delta High School. What do you think the biggest advantages for you playing safety, having that knowledge that you had playing quarterback in high school?
Just knowing how offenses work, really. Kind of knowing, being able to watch film and see their tendencies, watching film like a quarterback, and just picking up on things that defenses do just to make me that much better and that much quicker in my play in the back end of the defense.
Okay, and your brother played at Delta and broke the school record for tackles there at Delta. Does he ever tease you that he's a better defender because of that? You played both ways, but you also played safety.
I know he's a better tackler. He's legit. I mean, can't get much any more credit than him. I mean, he's always going to be my little brother, but he's a solid player too.
And he's doing good things over there at DePaul. That's good to hear.
Yeah, and he'll be at DePaul. He'll play football for them in the fall. So what was last week like defensively during the week preparing for Reinhardt? It's a wing T. You guys dominated that game. It was one of the most impressive defensive performances we can recall in so many years here at Marian. What was the week like and then facing that offense in real time on Saturday?
I mean, we treated it like any other week. Came in on Monday, watched film. Obviously, they ran a different type of offense that we're not used to. Our coaches put together a great game plan. Went out on Tuesday, practiced Wednesday through Thursday, and then came out on Friday and just tried to play as fast as possible and came out successful.
Your guys is on your defense, your stats and everything on defense are incredible. Number one in total defense, number one in scoring. Your group has been intact there as far as personnel-wise. What do you think the biggest difference between last year and this year is, not just, you know, the extra year of experience?
Obviously, like you said, the extra year experience really helps. But I think just us being that much closer to each other a year later, like me and Nakai last year had a little riff in the playoff game, but me and him, I mean, we did a lot of leadership things with Coach Henninger in the offseason and really got developed as leaders, and Mac Dutra the same way. We're all sitting in those leadership meetings, and it just, I think, made us that much better, that much closer as a team.
You're not the first person to sit here and say, family, we feel closer this year than we did 1 year ago. What was it about Marian? What brought you to this university? And what are some of the things that you'll take away from Marian that you really didn't anticipate learning or gaining that knowledge, maybe even like the leadership stuff that you guys did in the off season?
I mean, coming here to Marian, it was kind of like my community back home. It's kind of small. I mean, I'm from kind of like a school out in the country a little bit, but this school being in the city, it's kind of the same feel though to me, just because it's so small and it's a tight-knit group of people. But I mean, the lessons that I learned here, I could use, I mean, as long as I go on. I mean, I learned a lot here. Respect people, treat people with respect. I mean, don't take anything for granted and just be take advantage of your opportunities, really.
Mm-hmm. We've enjoyed watching you play. I mean, with him and Wilson back there, have to be two of the biggest safeties that you're going to find.
Yeah, we said that last year as sophomores, the size of them alone stands out, and the way they fit run gaps and play both run and pass defense is really impressive.
So now you've watched Cumberlands. You get ready for the Patriots coming up this weekend. What do they pose? What kind of view or look do they give you on offense?
They're going to try and spread you out. They have a running type quarterback. He's going to try and run the ball. A lot of 10 personnel, so they're going to be in trips and doubles quite a bit and try and throw the ball down the field. So we just have to be great in what we do every week. I think our defensive line will have a good day, and just in the back end, we got to play deep ball defense, like Coach Tussie always says.
Yeah, a completely different look. You go from the wing tee to now, they'll spread you out. That'll happen in the NAIA postseason. One final question for Ryley Pease. So what are you studying here at Marian?
Exercise science.
Nice. Excellent. We're glad you're here. We love watching you play. Congratulations on the playoff win. And appreciate you joining us here on the Knight Show.
Thanks for having me.
That's Ryley Pease, defensive back. Had a big pick in the win on Saturday against Reinhardt. We'll see what he and his teammates have in store coming up this Saturday. More on the Knight Show on MU Knights TV.
Is your building haunted or infested with icky snakes? Then tear it down. The Raise Trash Demolition Squad can flatten buildings up to 3 stories tall. Whether it's a commercial or residential structure, the Raise Trash Demo experts will make it go boom. And with their roll-off containers, they'll haul away the mess quicker than you can say, "Hey, there used to be a building there." Bring your old fire trap to its knees with Raise Trash.
RaiseTrash.com.
Raise Trash.
Johnny William joins us now on the Knight Show on MU Knights TV. Number 4 all-league wide receiver for Marian. Finally got an opportunity to play in a playoff game. Johnny, you had to watch last year, although the weather stunk. How was it? What was that feeling like to finally get a chance to play in the postseason? And you had an incredible game, and we'll talk about maybe the moment of the game as well later on.
It was just exciting. I knew myself it was my first game in the playoffs, and it was just exciting all week, just getting ready for it and knowing that the game was going to be different from regular season. So it was very exciting.
Now, what was different when you say it was different? What did you think that would entail? As you thought during the week it will be different, and then what did you see on Saturday?
It's just like in the playoffs, every play matters regardless, but in the playoffs you can feel like, okay, this play, like every play seems like it's a championship play, a game winner play, so you just got to give it your, but we give it our all every play regardless, so you can just feel it though.
So you had a touchdown reception in the game. That was a crazy good adjustment to make that play, but the biggest play of the game to us up there was your defensive tackle. So what happens? Because you're on the opposite side of the field, you see the interception. You don't know if you have a shot at him or not. What's going through your head right then when you have to know you have to take that angle at the end zone and cut him off?
Just don't give up. You can't be on offense and give up touchdowns. That's number one. You just can't give up touchdowns. And I know with our defense, if you give them any chance, they can come out with a great opportunity. So I gave them a chance and they stopped them. So it came out to be a great play.
Sure was.
After the tackle, we could see frustration. Like You see, you were upset that they took the pick and they went that far. But you chased them down, you made the tackle. Were you seated or were you standing on the sideline when you saw the defense make the play and give you guys the ball back?
I was standing up until I was watching every play from there on
out. And then your tackle, essentially in their stop, prevents a touchdown. 14-0 at that point in the game, and you mentioned how important it is. Have your teammates told you, have your coaches told you just how important of a play that was?
Yeah.
It's a great teaching moment, too.
Yes. Mac, right after the game, I'm in my locker, and Mac just, while he like, I know you don't know this probably, but you probably made the biggest play of the game, biggest tackle of the game, just giving us a chance. And from there on, I realized, like, yeah, it was important.
Did you get a sticker?
I was going to say, yeah. Did you get your defensive hatchet?
No,
you got to get that. No, you should get two for that.
All right, Brock Carabola.
Double hatchet, Nate Jones.
I know Coach Carabola watches this show, right? Yeah, he needs a sticker by the time they roll out on Saturday, right?
Yes, absolutely.
It's a huge play.
Like our great tight end used to say, Nate Jones, hatchet.
Now, you top 100 yards, as you mentioned, the touchdown catch, the adjustment. The ball is in the air. The flight's in the air. Is that instinct? How do you make that type of play in the rain?
I just got to adjust to the ball. I knew it was going to be tough. When I seen it coming at me, I was like, oh, this is going to be tough. But I just had to make a play for my teammates and for the team.
And not only was it raining and everything, that was the number one pass defense last week in the nation that you were going against. So looking forward now to Cumberlands this weekend, what are they percent on defense that you think you can take advantage of?
They seem like they man up too, have a lot of man-to-man. So if we can win our one-on-ones and quarterback get time, which he usually do, we should be good.
Mm-hmm. Have you noticed, what were you going to ask about?
Oh, yeah. So I was going to say, now we have video evidence, especially thinking back to the Taylor game specifically. When you came back, there would be, you know, safeties rolling up, multiple guys that have their eyes on number four. Do you feel that at all when you're out there? Like, you know that there's a couple guys on you that might give someone else an opportunity, or do you just go out there and do your job?
I usually see it. They usually communicate, and the sound backer and the safety usually communicate. So I can see that they're trying to double me or whatever, but we got playmakers all around.
So roll that safety down and hit Greg on the post. Yeah. And that's happened multiple times. So.
And then how about your play where you catch it on the near sideline, you face up your defender, and you went right around him on Saturday? That happens once a game?
Yeah, not often, yeah.
I mean, when he has a chance to square up somebody and goes around somebody.
Oh, yeah.
Have you been measured at your top speed yet? Do you have any idea miles per hour?
No.
Come on. Really?
Next-gen stats. Come on.
Yes, because I'm sure you have been, and this might be a silly question. Do you think you have been faster on a field than you were on the catch you made along the far sidelines against Taylor, the 60-yarder? Do you know what play I'm talking about?
Yeah.
You were flying on that play. Do you feel fast in those
moments?
We're
asking because we're not fast, so we're just wondering.
I mean, when we
like
watched it on screen,
fast.
It was... Boom. Yeah, I mean, you were gone. Do you know when you're at top speed out there on the football field?
Nah, I really don't. I tell Snoop and them all the time, they be talking about how fast I am. I tell them all the time, I really don't feel fast.
Wow.
Well, you're fast.
You're very fast.
Yeah, you're fast. Defenses will tell you you're fast. When he walked into the room ready to do the show, Ryley Pease said, what do you call him? Johnny Rocket.
Johnny Rocket. I like that. Nice.
That's good. Hey, congratulations on the playoff win. Outstanding performance, 6 straight 100-yard games for this guy. A touchdown in 6 out of 7 games. He's healthy, he's on the offense, and you're a big-time difference maker out there, Johnny. Appreciate you joining us.
Thank you.
That's Johnny Williams, the star wide receiver for the Marian Knights. Back with more on The Knight Show on MU Knights TV.
Still waiting? You could have been seen by an orthopedic specialist at Ortho Indy Urgent Care. Avoid the wait, cost, and drama of the ER. Ortho Indy Urgent Care. Orthopedic care without the drama. Find a location near you. Still waiting? You could have been seen by an orthopedic specialist at Ortho Indy Urgent Care. Avoid the wait, cost, and drama of the ER. Ortho Indy Urgent Care. Orthopedic care without the drama. Find a location near you.
The head football coach for Marian University, Mark Henninger, joins us on The Knight Show. Marian wins in the first round against Reinhardt. Coach, 17-7 the final. I mean, it was pretty much a perfect day for you guys. It's pouring down rain. It seems to be that you guys are getting used to playing in these type of elements, but we've heard people say it, playoff football is different. That was a really, really good, competitive, hard-fought game. Congrats on the win. What was your message to the team after that W against Reinhardt?
I was just impressed with just the mental toughness of our group. You know, I mean, I told him this after the game, and you know, here some hours later, I still feel the same. That might be the most just mentally tough performance I've ever been a part of. You know, I mean, when you look back with this group and what we went through a year ago in the playoffs, and for that game to start the way it started with the kickoff return for a touchdown, we get good field possession, we throw an interception, get a stop, get good field possession, throw an interception, mm-hmm. that the ball ends up in the guy's lap and he runs it back, and we're on the verge. I mean, they have really, I think, just about every opportunity for our guys to just be like, just throw in the towel and it ain't our year. And we get an incredible play by Johnny William, to force the guy out and give our defense a chance to go out and play. But our guys, they never flinched. They didn't falter and just hung in there and battled. And it was an absolute battle for 60 minutes.
You talk about mental toughness, the adversity, all that stuff. And we were thinking and saying it all up there in the booth. And I know you already mentioned it, but what can you say about the effort from Johnny William mm-hmm. to do that down the field, cut him off, and give your defense a shot?
Yeah, I mean, it was an incredible play. We watched it in our team meeting on Sunday, and darn near got a standing ovation from the team. I mean, it was just, same thing. I mean, he could have just thrown his hands up in the air, like, man, what else can go wrong today? And he didn't. I mean, you watch him run. I mean, literally just weave and run all the way through everybody, and he's passing guys. And, there's two or three times where we could have knocked him out of bounds, and he just stays in, and for him just to just superhuman effort on his part, really, and knocks him out of the three, like I said, and gives our defense a chance to go out. And our defense right now is playing well, and we were excited for Saturday, and it was to give those guys a chance, and obviously it worked out.
And we know in the playoffs you face different teams, different styles. You do during the regular season as well. You just left the wing tee. Now, what's the type of offense that you see coming up this Saturday with the visitors?
Yeah, I mean, it's more of a spread, conventional type offense. They got a great quarterback who can do a little bit of everything. He's really athletic, runs the ball well, keeps plays alive with his feet. There's a lot of quarterback run game, which obviously presents a challenge because now you're not playing 11 on 10, you're playing 11 on 11, and he can throw it well, and they got some receivers outside that can run and catch it, and standing next to him, he's got a couple of really good backs. There's a freshman that we think he's pretty special when you mm-hmm. see him on film. And so they've got some, a lot of weapons on offense, and they put up a lot of points this year.
Yep.
The defense is playing outstanding right now. Number one in total defense, number one in scoring. It's hard to even think that you keep seeing them improve, but they have. What is the secret sauce of this defense that makes them just keep just balling out everything?
Yeah, they are. I don't know, honestly. They are. It's as competitive a group of people as I've ever been around. They are ultra competitive all the time. They're competing. Right now there's like, darn near like, throat slitting competition over production points. It's like every day or every Sunday we come in and go over the production for the game, and then here's the production for the year, and it's guys going back and forth on who has more and who should have more, and they just compete all the time. And I think that they just love they love playing football, and they love playing football mm-hmm. with each other. You can really tell it's a tight-knit group, and you throw all those things together and you got the recipe for something pretty special.
We've had a lot of players come in here and tell us this year it feels like a family, how close they are. Last week Mac Dutra told us it's hard to do this. It's not offense against defense. It's one group, whereas in a lot of teams, a lot of situations, maybe even last year, it was offense against defense. How have you and your coaching staff been able to, change isn't the right word, but kind of instill that thought? How did you go about bringing this team together even more than we've seen them in the past?
Yeah, I think that goes back to 2017. Our 2017 camp was really, it was really competitive, but we got on, when we opened up that year with St. X, and you get on two buses, and you drive up there and you get into two different locker rooms, and I mean it was literally two teams. You know, we had an offense, we had a defense, and there was so much back and forth. Our spring practice was really competitive, and it almost got, I don't want to say combative, over competitive, but it almost got to that point where, I mean, the offense versus the defense for so long, mm-hmm. and then we just really didn't, we were lifting, and the offense had a lifting time, the defense had a lifting time. We did it in the winter. The offense got, it was so really just about everything we did was split. And then going into last season, we made a really concentrated effort on getting everything together. We blew up the locker room. The locker room when you were in there, it's always, the offensive line, they're all together. The defensive line's all together. And, yeah. and even though the offense and defensive line might be next to each other, in terms of one row over or whatever, it's still the offensive line's all together. So we don't do that anymore now. I mean, it's completely, everybody's locker in the locker room is thought out. I mean, it's we've planned everything out to try to bring, do as much as we can to get offense and defense together. Obviously, there's still, during camp, it still gets, as you get to the end of camp, you remember this, it gets to where you guys, they just hate one another. But I think we'd laid such a strong foundation of intermixing the offense and defensive groups together as much as we can to try to get that feel of, oneness and family and we and team and all those things that are so important in this game. So, I think that's really, you take that, you combine that with, we've got really strong leadership right now and our guys, you can tell they truly care for one another.
Yeah, because we hear it week in and week out. Yeah. Family. I mean, they repeat that right. kind of message.
And I do think the leadership jump, just the experience alone, yeah. a lot of those guys, we heard Ryley Pease talk about it too. So seeing that, you can see it out there, the leadership and the camaraderie.
Yeah, yeah. And the leadership, it showed on mm-hmm. Saturday in the wing.
Yeah, you got to have it. You got to have it in that
yeah.
thing.
Yeah, absolutely you do. And now it doesn't get any easier as Marian moves into the quarterfinals. That's that football coach, Mark Henninger. Thanks for the time. Congrats. Looking forward to watching the squad play on Saturday.
Great. Another week of football.
That's right. Another week. Another opportunity. Back with more on the Knight Show on MU Knights TV.
This is the Pepsi for America's best barbecue. Worthy of 100-mile detours and 1,000 likes. Looks good. This is the Pepsi for mopping, dipping, and dousing. Whatever you're craving, this is the Pepsi for you. This is the Pepsi for serious fans and serious eats. This is the Pepsi for Sundays at the ballpark and days off at your favorite pizza joint. Right, Aaron?
Best slice in New York.
Whatever you're craving, this is the Pepsi for you.
MUKnights TV with head coach Ashley Pritchard as her team qualifies for the final site and will head to Sioux City, Iowa, December 3rd for the NAIA National Tournament. Coach, this is all new. You guys get to bypass the opening round, go straight to the final site. How proud are you of this team?
I'm very proud. At the beginning of the season, we had talked about what our goals were, and right now we've hit two of the three goals, so we came up, like I said, 3 points short on Saturday. But, this was a really big goal for us after coming so close last year, getting out of pool play. That was their number one goal, was they wanted to be able to bypass the opening round games. And so, with everything that this team has gone through all season with all the changes, I'm so proud for them, just so excited, and it's nice to get a couple days off here and then right back at it.
It's kind of strange, though, because you find out you're going, and now you have quite a bit of time till you go out there, and you don't know who's going to be in your pool. So how do you use these next couple weeks to just focus on yourselves and get ready?
Yeah, absolutely. The next couple days, we'll give them a little bit of a break, heal some of the injuries that we've got. But then the hardest part for us is not necessarily going to be what the outcome is of practice. It's making sure we keep them mentally focused, mentally tough, because it is such a long break. Essentially, we go back to an early camp schedule where, you've got two and a half weeks before you actually play. And, where the regular season, you're going maybe one or two practices with a match. So to be able to keep them focused is what we're really going to have to work on. But I know they're motivated. I know they're excited, so just couldn't be more proud for them.
You're always learning as a coach, so you've been out there a couple times now. What's something you've picked up over the last few years that you hope you can apply to this year?
Yeah, absolutely. It's being able to stay focused. You've got so much free time out there with only playing one game a day, so to be able to put together a schedule and not just keep it, okay, do this, or, just you've got this free time, but keeping them regimented on what we're going to do, keeping that schedule pretty much the same every day. This team really likes their schedules. So to be able to put something solid together, for the entire week once we're out there, but just being able to enjoy the moment too. I think sometimes you put so much pressure on going out there and being able to win that you don't enjoy the moment. And so we've got to be able to keep them focused, but just to really be able to enjoy that experience, because there's not very many teams that get the chance to go out to Iowa to be able to enjoy that. So combination of those two things.
Well, hey, it's been a fun ride, and we're glad it gets to continue. So we'll see you out there in Sioux City December 3rd.
Great, thank you.
I've always liked Indianapolis. I've been interested in the bigger city life. The community and everything fell into place.
With my degree, I plan on becoming a pediatric nurse. Indianapolis has several hospitals and different options to choose from as to where I should go.
I chose Indianapolis because I love the Pacers, I love the Colts, and this is a basketball city. Just wanted to stay in the city, play in front of my friends and family, and try to give Marian my best.
Welcome back to the Knight Show. Good luck to the volleyball team next week in the national tournament. Also of note, the wrestling team ranked fourth in the country. And good luck to women's soccer as well. They'll hit the road after Thanksgiving. They will then play Monday in Orange Beach, Alabama, as they have made the round of 16 in the NAIA National Championship for soccer. So good luck to the team. And there will be watch parties around campus. Check out Twitter, MU Knights. Check out the website, or you, of course, can watch it at NAIA Network as well. So there'll be watch parties all over to cheer on the soccer team coming up on Monday. On Saturday here at St. Vincent Field, Marian will be on the gridiron in the quarterfinals against Cumberlands. The Patriots are 10-1, and they do feature a Mid-South Defensive Player of the Year. Tyler Pendleton, a 6'2 senior, had 12 tackles in their win against Kaiser. They have a defensive lineman, Kumi Sarpong. I might pronounce that better come game time on Saturday. Fourth in the NAIA with 12 sacks. And as Coach Mark Henninger told us, they've got some players as well on offense. They'll spread you out. So a completely different look than what we saw this past Saturday.
Yeah, so just doing some early prep here, looking at some of the numbers and the statistics. It's a very balanced offense. They're 11th in the country in points per game and running the football, 18th overall in offense. They do give up 300 yards a game on defense, but as you mentioned, a lot of really good individual players. 118 tackles for Tyler Pendleton, and you did mention Kumi Sarpong, 12 sacks. That's a really big number for sacks.
From a nose guard, because they'll play three down.
Right, so it's a three down look, which we haven't seen in a few weeks as well. So they're going to present some different things, as you had already mentioned. It's crazy how you go from a wing T philosophy offense to a spread offense, but the Marian defense will be ready. They're first in the country.
And they have a couple of skill players that did make first team in the Bluegrass division. Darius Young, a wide receiver, 8 touchdowns, 53 catches. And then Marti Smith, 85 yards a game rushing. He did have 11 touchdowns on the season. So this will be a balanced attack and with a quarterback that will run it as well. So they'll Marian will have their hands full, and you'd expect that as you get to the round of eight.
Right, yeah, I'm glad you mentioned that. On offense, dual threat quarterback, over 2,500 yards and 26 touchdowns total this year. A lot of big hit receivers. All these guys, all four of their top receivers average over 12 yards per catch, two guys over 20 yards per catch. So it's going to be a type of situation where they're going to want to hit those big plays that we haven't seen a lot given up by Marian this year.
So do your homework, because the Marian defense is legit. They are so, with multiple O's, good. Mm-hmm. All right. So you talk about averaging 20 yards a catch.
Yeah.
The Marian defense has allowed how many 20-yard pass plays this season?
Like, is it
10?
Wow.
10.
Yeah.
They've allowed 10 pass plays over 40 yards. Yeah. Running plays over 20 yards. Four on the season, folks. All right. Last week, Reinhardt, the Eagles, had one play that went over 9 yards. And it was a first down run that went for 13. Look, I know it was raining and it was cold.
Yeah.
Both teams had to deal with it. Domination in the opening round.
That's really the only way you can put it.
So now you move on to the quarterfinals. And here's our schedule coming up for the rest of the NAIA in the quarterfinals. Morningside is 11-0. They have won 39 straight games.
That's a lot.
Whoa. They will host St. X. St. Xavier's 9-2. Morningside's 4-0 against St. X. Third straight year they've met in the quarters. And it has not been pretty. Morningside has walloped them 51-14 in 18, 52-7 in 17. They have been mismatches, so St. X makes a familiar trip. Kansas Wesleyan beat up on Baker. This one caught a lot of people's eye because Kansas Wesleyan, Coyotes, really haven't played many people, but they are 12-0. They've scored 37 points at least in every game this season. They take on Lindsey Wilson.
Yeah, when you look at the NAIA scoreboard every week, and there for a while, Kansas Wesleyan was ranked 2 and Marian was 3. So those are Morningside and Kansas Wesleyan are always two of the scores that I look at first.
Yeah.
And every week, we say they haven't played anybody, but we really don't know too much. We haven't seen a ton of film on them. their score differential is huge
each
week. So that is a team to continue to look out for.
And they scored on 6 out of 7 possessions, touchdowns in 6 of 7 possessions over the second and third quarter. Lindsey Wilson shocks St. Francis. They scored 2 touchdowns in the last 5 minutes of that game, maybe last 3 minutes of that game. Mm-hmm. They remain undefeated at 11-0. Their quarterback, Cameron Dukes, 42 touchdowns total this year, 32 through the air, 10 on the ground, ran for 2 scores against St. Francis. Lindsey Wilson makes it into the quarterfinals. Right. That should be a fun game.
And it will be a fun game. And you mentioned Lindsey Wilson and the Big South this year. Cumberlands and Lindsey Wilson met in the final week of the regular season. Very close game. Lindsey Wilson came out on top. I think it was 24-21. That is the only loss for Cumberlands this
year. And Cumberlands, as we mentioned, Marion will be the third straight game they'll face an undefeated team. Final game to talk about is Grandview at 12-0. They took on College of Idaho at 11-0. This is incredible how Grandview wins. They beat Concordia, who scores a touchdown with 5 minutes to play in the game, and Concordia gets the extra point block, so they lose 31-30. Kicking game cost them 2 games this year to the Cardinals.
Concordia has lost 3 games this year, 1 to Marian, 1 to St. Francis, and now 2 Grandview. 2 of those games, not the one against Marian, they lost on the final play was a blocked kick. Very unfortunate for them.
And Grandview needed this. 3 straight first-round exits prior to that win. The last time they made the quarters was 2015, and Grandview lost 2. That's correct. Now, let me tell you a little something about College of Idaho. Do you know much about them at all?
I know they're in Idaho.
Okay, there you go. This guy. I'm telling you what. This guy.
Sharp.
So they scored 70 points in their opening game against Ottawa out of Arizona, all right? It was their first playoff appearance since 1953.
Nice.
All right? And the 70 points is the second most points they've scored since 1925.
Wow.
They blew the doors off that squad. There were over 1,000 yards of total offense in that game between Ottawa and Idaho. And here's the thing. The Frontier League typically shows up in the playoffs.
They do. Once they get some representatives in there, it does, and it changes a lot.
Yeah,
that's the thing. This year it's Idaho. It's been Carroll in the past. We've seen Eastern Oregon. What was the other Oregon?
Southern Oregon, twice in the championship
game.
How
could I forget them? Maybe I just erased it from my mind, I guess. But, yeah, so they always have a different representative, it seems like, but they always get – and there's always a Frontier representative in the quarterfinals, it seems like.
That should be a fun game. And College of Idaho, their quarterback, Darius James Peterson, over 10,000 yards of total offense in his career. The quarterback is the leading rusher in Idaho history, too, with over 3,000 yards. So there's a quick look. It's a lot of info on the other quarters.
Yeah, it is.
That's what you're going to get from us.
Night show. Right? We're here for you.
See this? So here's what we have in store. We have soccer coming up following the weekend on Monday. You have volleyball as well following the weekend coming up on Monday. We know the wrestling team's highly ranked, and there's a big-time football game coming up Saturday here at St. Francis Field against Cumberlands. We want to see you here on Saturday. It is Thanksgiving. We hope everyone enjoyed Thanksgiving. And take it easy. We're filming this before the holiday break, so I'll give you an early warning. Take your time. Chew slow. Make sure you follow with liquids. All
okay,
right?
It'll get be through. Tough, but yeah.
Yeah, see if you can do that.
I gotcha.
And then we've got the big one coming up on Saturday in the quarters against Cumberlands, a game you can watch on the ISC Sports Network app. You can download it on any smart TV, any device, Roku, Apple TV, Fire Stick, Google Chrome, and, of course, go to MUKnights.com for all the latest. And keep it on Twitter, at MUKnights, to keep up to date with Marian Athletics. Good to hear from the head football coach, Mark Henninger. Good to finally get a chance to talk with Ryley Pease.
Yeah, the night classes, we've been trying to get him all season.
We finally got him. And Johnny William, I mean, the play of the game.
It is.
And it's great to hear his teammates tell him that afterwards on the big tackle that he had. Thank you for watching the Night Show today. Enjoy the holidays. And tune in Saturday for the quarterfinals of the football game as the Knights take on Cumberlands. Ready for now, second round action to the playoffs.
Hey, playing past Thanksgiving, that's what it's all about.
That is exactly what it is. Enjoy the holiday, and enjoy yours. I'll see you on Saturday.
Oh, I will.
Thanks for watching the Night Show on MUKnights TV.